me do this.
Okay, you're on.
Okay. May all that I say and all the chizuk that we gain bring nachat ruach to Hashem, yitbarach, invoke rachamei shamayim for all those in need of yeshuot and nechamot and service as chud for Klal Yisrael. Amen.
Amen.
Tonight's shiur should be dedicated for the refuah shlema of all Am Yisrael and amongst them Chagit Ranana Bat Sarah, Shoshana Shulamit Bat Sarah Liba, Reuven Pesach Ben Hemya, and Mahavdi Leilui Nishmat Arya Leib Ben Shepzel. May his neshama bask in the divine radiance amongst all those who departed from this world. Amen. So tonight is the last shiur in Chodesh Elul. Tonight is the last Wednesday night of the year.
It's Tuesday.
Oh! No.
One more Tuesday.
And tonight, all I kept thinking about today was, it's the last... Okay, I have one more day. One last day. Oh, look how parent. You see how frightening? I'm telling you, I'm actually fearful. Why, Hashem? It's good. It's good to feel this way. It actually is actually good to feel this way, to feel this injection of, oh, it's coming.
Not
debilitating, but we should be on alert. And we should feel this dahaf, this injection of, Time is running out. It's good. It's good to feel that way. I think, yeah, maybe I'm just a little bit too much with it, but it's good. Okay. So, being that it is the last shiur, though, yes, in Chodesh Elul, before we come back. By the way, to remind everyone, yes, 2 weeks from today, the trip to Kibrei Tzadikim, Tuesday, Bezlat Hashem, we're going to do a beautiful... I called it Coming Back to Our Roots, Kibrei Tzadikim, Har Minuchot, then lunch at a beautiful restaurant in Yerushalayim, and then after that, Har HaZeitim, and after that, Mincha at the Kotel. And just a real rejuvenation of spirit, a day of introspection, Be'ezrat Hashem, during the 10 days, day of tshuva, of tefillah. Anybody wants to join, you can contact me, or oritriter@gmail.com. Be'ezrat Hashem, we're looking forward to a beautiful day. Hopefully we'll also record some of it, so we'll be able to post some of it onto our anytime.com. Being that it is the last shiur of the year, Hakar Satov is certainly called for. I must take a moment to thank Tzipi for hosting us the entire year with such grace, with such poise. Always, you know what, I don't even have to knock, I just feel at home. I just open up the door and I just come in and there's always something yummy on the table. We're always looking and smelling to see what's awaiting us. And I really, I if it wasn't for you, it just would not have the same Emuna environment and feeling. So thank you so much. Really, and how many times she's just left the door and, you know, not even here, ready for us to come in. Thank you very much. Thank you to everyone who comes every Tuesday and learns with me and gives me such great chizuk and gives me a form to be able to grow in Emuna. Thank you everyone from TorahAnytime.com. Thank you TorahAnytime.com for always being there and posting the shiurim and allowing it to radiate to a wider audience. I'm very privileged and very humbled. And of course, thank you Hashem for putting the right words in my mouth, Be'ezrat Hashem, and the right meditations in my heart to be able to come here every Tuesday and speak Hashem's holy, beautiful Torah, Be'ezrat Hashem, to so many women. So why can't we live without Hashem? Really, the shiur is, can't live without you, Hashem. So today we're going to explore the question, why? What is it that I need? Why is it that I cannot live simply without Hashem? None of us, we cannot live without Hashem. So we're going to discover tonight maybe some of the things we're going to sort of regain, some of the perspective that we talk about all year long of how important it is to live a life of Emuna. But I think it's important tonight to recap really what it does for our Neshama, how important it is for our Neshama to live a life of Emuna, to live a life connected to the Kadosh Baruch Hu, to live a life of happiness, of purpose, of meaning, genuine meaning. So, as we know, the studies all tell us that man is constantly searching for purpose. no matter who we are, what we are, man, woman, and from wherever we are in this world, whatever religion anybody decides to adhere to, everyone's always looking for purpose. We're always constantly striving. In fact, as the neshama is described by Chazal as constantly being lifted up like the candle, constantly striving to go up, never settled. The neshama never settles. It's always moving back and forth, always on demand. Give me, feed me, I'm in search. I want to be nurtured, I want to be fed. Feed me, like this little man in the bubble saying, feed me, yes, that's the neshama constantly. And for all you women out there, yes, the woman inside of us, not the man, yes. Feed me, I need to be taken care of. Remember me, I need to be taken care of. And the reason is because the neshama knows that there's higher meaning, that there's more to life, that there's a higher purpose for why we're here, and that neshama won't give us rest. And if we don't feed that neshama, she's going to cry out, pain, I'm in pain. Do you feel it? Do you feel this unsettling feeling? Do you feel this lack of tranquility? Then neshama is saying, you're not doing something for me. You've forgotten about me. And so we have to understand that living a life of purpose, living a life where the neshama is properly fed and taken care of, obviously, at the end of the day, feeds us. And so that is the connecting of why I need to live with Hashem. Is because when I live with Hashem, we're going to see tonight that when we live with Hashem, in essence, I'm being loyal to myself. I'm feeding myself.
לא יודעת, את אומרת שאם you feed her neshama, she's quiet, doesn't mean that she's quiet.
Imagine
a mommy that she's nervous with her kids, for instance. This is connected to Avodat HaMidot, but not so much what you're talking about.
So you feed the neshama, and of course she's always going to want more, but she's going to feel settled with what you're giving her if you give her the proper food. She won't be, and neshama won't be, the proper food is Torah. We're going to see that tonight. Torah, connection to Hashem, feeling that there's purpose, there's eternity in every moment, there's an opportunity for endless reward and value in everything that I do, every thought that I think, everything that I say, everything that I do. It's all tied to eternal divine purpose. So if we live our lives based on that principle, then Be'ezrat Hashem, we should be able to feel tranquil to a very large degree if we constantly feed that food to our neshama. So what we need to do, not only now, but in particular now, but throughout the year, we always have to do, and we've said this before, every good business needs to do an annual or a weekly or a monthly sort of gathering with its, you know, members of the board. How am I doing? How's the inventory? Are we making a profit? To do a settling of accounts, to see where we are. So as we say, our life is a business deal. We're here for a certain period of time. We want to gain profit from it. We want to, and profit means not only in the future, but also means from now. I need to be able to say to myself, why am I here? And I need to be able to answer that question very instantly. If I can answer that question at any given moment, if someone asks me and approaches me, why are you here? What's your mission? I should be able to answer that. And if I don't have an answer at the tip of my tongue, that means I haven't settled my accounts. Then how can a business, the first thing a business has to do is write a mission statement. The first thing, no bank is going to lend you a dime unless you present them with a mission statement. Now, it's not so much for them as it is for you. They want to know that they're dealing with someone who knows exactly what they're doing. Not that I'm just, oh, well, it seems to me like the, you know, this world needs another, you know, 5 and 10 store. No, what is it? What are you trying to do? So we need to constantly ask, and many times that mission is going to change also to some degree as we feel like we're moving or we're drifting. We have to constantly reevaluate that question. What am I here? What's that? Am I paying attention to that inner voice? That inner voice talking to me, yelling to me. Am I paying attention to my emotions? And my emotional state really defines and depicts for me where I am in terms of my mission. According to where I am, if I'm satisfied and content with my life and happy with the circumstances of my life, then of course I will feel like I'm in tuned with what it is that that I'm here to do. Now, something very interesting that we have to look at during this month, during Elul, during Rosh Hashanah. Now, all this work has to be done before Rosh Hashanah. Why? Because when we approach Rosh Hashanah, one of the things that we do in Shul, one of the parts of our tefillah is called Malchuyot. Malchuyot means that we anoint Hashem to be king. That's not something that I could just readily approach the stage and say, I anoint you, Hashem, to be king. Wait, what does it mean? I have to prepare myself beforehand. Now, how do I anoint Hashem to be king? Is when a servant is subject to the listening to its master. If I want to show my obedience, if I want to stay under the jurisdiction, so to speak, of the master, it means that I have to display satisfaction. I have to be happy with the way that my master is treating me. That's how he knows that I want him to continue to be my master, to be, that's how the servant shows the master that he wants to continue to serve him. We have to come to Rosh Hashanah with satisfaction in our life. We have to come to Rosh Hashanah saying, Hashem, you know what, Hashem? I'm happy. I'm happy with my life. I'm content with everything that you've given me till now. And by us saying that, by us going into the tefillah of Rosh Hashanah, what is one of the reasons why we have to dress hagigi on occasion in celebration? What are we celebrating? We're celebrating the appointment and the anointment of a Kadosh Baruch Hu on us. If I'm not happy, if I'm in dispute with something that's going on in my life, how can I say, Hashem, I want to appoint you to be in charge of me one more year? It's a falsehood. I'm not being truthful with myself. So this is what I have to do before Rosh Hashanah comes. Before Rosh Hashanah comes, I have to be able to clearly feel, I can't live without you, Hashem. I need you in my life. I need you to be the master. I need you to be the King of Kings. I need you to show me the way. I have no clue what I'm doing. I have no clue what I'm, should I turn right now? Should I turn left? Up, down? When should I go? When should I move? What should I do? I have a dollar bill. What should I invest it in? Where is my next step taking me? And so unless, if I don't do that avoda before Rosh Hashanah, how can I stand there in shul and say, at Hashem hu amelech, hayom harat haolam, today you created the world. How can I do that? Hashem, if there's one day that we really have to know that we're going under x-ray vision, CAT scan, ultrasound, x-ray, bone scan, bone density, blood work. Hashem is taking us, doing all of these checkups on us. Nothing's going to be hidden. The Chazal teachers, like a flock of sheep just passing through. That's what we're gonna be doing. Hashem is looking through, she's anointing me to king, but she seems to have one problem with her husband there. I mean, she thinks that if she married the neighbor, she would have a better life. So how is she appointing me to king? She thinks that something that I did for her was not right. How is she appointing me to be king? So if we don't take the time, and that's part of the tshuva process, if I don't take the time before Rosh Hashanah to sit down with myself and analyze myself, did I ever tell the story here about the Baal Shem Tov HaKadosh, how he saw in Ruach HaKodesh the L'chaim? Anybody know? Okay, so we're going to say this. This is, even if I did, it begs repetition. One Yom Kippur, the Baal Shem Tov HaKadosh was in the middle of the tefillah. In the middle of the tefillah, everyone's just, you know, with tears and with true kavana, and the Baal Shem Tov HaKadosh suddenly out of nowhere starts to smile from ear to ear. Nobody understands. Most of the times, the disciples never understood what the Baal Shem Tov had under his sleeve, but this time, they were baffled. All right, Yom Kippur passed, Baruch Hashem, everything's good, the Baal Shem Tov rushes off and goes and visits, somehow Ruach HaKodesh knows he's going to visit some old man in some hut somewhere outside of the skirts of where, you know, outskirts of the city where he was davening. Knocks on the door, the old man looks at him, obviously no, it's humbled by the Baal Shem Tov, would he please come in? The Baal Shem Tov sits down and says, tell me, what did you do before Yom Kippur? No, for the Rav, really, I mean, I'm asking you, I came all the way here, tell me, what did you do before Yom Kippur? I want to know. With his humbled eyes, and, you know, eyes looking downward, he says, I'll be honest with you, all year round, I have some disputes with Hashem. I mean, look, one day my flock, I found one of my chickens died. One day I have a problem with my wife. One day suddenly I realize that my health is, you know, lacking. Every time there's something else. Before Yom Kippur, I took myself a little schnapps cup, poured myself a cup of schnapps, lifted a l'chaim. I said, you know what, Hashem, let bygones be bygones. All year round, I'm upset with you. I have complaints. I come with you to you with tainas and complaints, and I'm not very happy, and I'm angry at you. Let's do a l'chaim, Hashem. I'll make up with you. I agree not to argue with you, not to be angry with you, not to dispute anything that you do if you agree to do the same with me. L'chaim, l'chaim. And he drinks his schnapps, and that's how he goes into Yom Kippur. I say this, I have shivers. It's such a beautiful, simplistic story. Believe it or not, the Baal Shem Tov Beruach HaKodesh saw this in Beruach HaKodesh on Yom Kippur and saw that there was what they call Sha'ashuim. There was an amusement park going on in Shemayim when this man did this before he entered in Yom Kippur. Sha'ashuim! There was mamash a Ferris wheel, the clowns, the stilts, the whole thing, the juggling act, the fire, the high wall, the whole thing. The whole party was going on in Shemayim. Because Hashem yearns for such simplicity. Such simplicity, that's what Hashem wants from us. Do a l'chaim with a Kaddish Baruch Hu. Let bygones be bygones. Hashem, what does Hashem teach us? Al kol peshaim techaseh ha'ahava. On all weaknesses, on all defects, love covers. Love covers all defects. If you really, really love someone, then if you see that person acting quote-unquote defective, you'll love them, you'll continue, because love has this ability to cover up all the mess, all the difficulties. Love has the ability to cover up everything. I love that person, I'll overlook it. I didn't see that. Because I love that person. Hashem says, love me enough so that even so to speak, if you think, chas v'sham, my kingship is defective. Chas v'sham, if you think I did something wrong, let your love be so immense to me that it should cover up my faults, God forbid. All of my faults, just cover it up. That's how I should. Simplicity to get to the point in our lives, God willing, one more week. Do we understand one more week?
Can you just say the last phrase? How we should talk to Hashem?
To get to the point where we say to Hashem, I love you so much. If I ever bared any tainas, if I ever had any complaints, if I ever questioned your royalty, your kingship, your hashgacha on me or the world, Hashem, please forgive me. I love you so much. How could I have even thought? How did I even have the brazenness, the chutzpah to even think that, God forbid, you did something that would have, God forbid, hurt me or hurt somebody?
And then say, Hashem, forgive
me. Hashem, forgive me. But wait, find it, please, Hashem, may you find it in Shemayim, the ability to forgive me for such for such foolishness, for such foolish thought of a limited mind, you know, of limited the limited intellect that I have. I've somehow questioned your, you know, the way you run the world. Hashem, please forgive me. Because I love you. Because I love you, Hashem. And my love is enough to put it at the forefront to understand that I was foolish if I ever, God forbid, said something, you know, expressed something, uttered something that, God forbid, gave the impression that I was somehow not happy with the way that you're in charge of the world. Who am I? Who am I to even think of that? Now, what's part of the one big problem that we have? One of the biggest problems that we have is that we try so hard to become godlike that we almost distort it to the point where it's actually counterfeit. So let's explain. We want to be close to Hashem. We yearn to be close to Hashem, but what happens is we get distorted. How do we get distorted? Let's look at this, something amazing. If we run after money, we don't really care for the money. What do we care for? We care for the idea that money buys us independence. Money buys us that I don't need to depend on anyone. I'm secure. I have my IRA fund ready to go, my pension, my 401k, everything's set up for me. I'm, as they say, Mr. Dow, I'm settled. Everything is ready and secure for me. I don't need any help from anyone. What a great feeling that is. To not have to worry about tomorrow. I'm independent. I'm solely on my own. I'm my own individual. That's what we yearn for when we want money. When we want fame, what do we want? We want the feeling of feeling valuable, significant. I'm important. I have meaning. I have stature. I'm important. What's the problem with that? Is that instead of us trying to emulate Hashem and becoming God-like, we want to become like God. We want to feel all-powerful. We want to feel in charge. We want to feel significant and of importance, that others will serve us. So it's a counterfeit. It's an imitation of trying to live a life to be God, and we're not God. So do you understand what the problem is? Everything that we're being sold is a distortion of what we really can be. And so what we need to understand is when we want to be like God, we really want to be and emulate God-like attributes. We want to be kind, we want to be compassionate, we want to be powerful, but in order to use that power to better others, not so others will serve us, but that so we can serve others. Do you understand the difference? Do you see how everything is distorted? So what happens is if I live a life, chas v'shalom, without God, then I want to be a God. And so what I'm in essence doing, I'm living a totally fictitious life. I'm living a life not of serving a higher self, but of serving myself. And so I'm really betraying my whole essence of my own life. And that's why it's so important that if there's anything that we could try to do in the next week is to realign our soul to try to emulate God-like attributes as opposed to trying to be, chas v'shalom, you know, God. And how do we do that? We do that by very loyal adherence to the Torah and the mitzvot, to the way of life of Torah and mitzvot. And Hashem writes, and Chazal teach us, that Am Yisrael is called the children of Israel. The children of Israel were called in relation to the fact that we keep the Torah. It says, right? Bereshit bara Elokim. Reshit, Chazal teach us, is the Torah, and Reshit is also Am Yisrael. Hashem created this world for one purpose, so that Am Yisrael would live, we would live, by what? How do we live? By keeping the Torah. Because by keeping the Torah, that is our derech, that's our pathway for keeping our God-like connection. There's no other way to be in touch with Hashem. For any other, unfortunately, who's again, we get distorted and distracted along the way. We come up with all our, you know, God-like visions of what God wants us to be. But for all, for us to understand is that Hashem created the Torah, and Hashem says, listen, there's no other way to connect to me other than through Torah. Yes, you could say I'm connected to Hashem by doing acts of chesed, but Hashem says the picture is not complete. You're tying yourself to me with one thread. You could be tying yourself to me through a rope. I'm telling you, there's more to tie yourself to me if you keep the full Torah and you keep all of the mitzvot. Because what are the mitzvot? The mitzvot are basically a physical expression of our emuna. It's our derech to keep in touch with the Kadosh Baruch Hu. We're not doing anybody a favor. Hashem doesn't need our mitzvot. Let's look at something very, very interesting. How is it that our avot and imaot, we're told by Chazal, kept Torah even before Har Sinai, before Matan Torah? They kept the Torah, we're told that. How is it? So when I love someone, I care enough to want to get to know them so that they don't even have to ask me for anything. I can already know what they want. What's the most beautiful expression that we can give to our children that we love, to our husbands, to our friends, to our mother? What's the most beautiful expression? Ma, I bought you the mango drink. I know you love it. She didn't have to tell me. I went through the effort to know what's important for her, and I went ahead and I did it. That's a physical expression of being able to say to that person, I love you. I care so much about you. I didn't need for you to say a word. I could read your mind. I know exactly what it is that you need. The Avot and the Imaot loved Hashem so much. They had such an intense connection to Hashem. They truly could not live without Hashem. And so they knew the mitzvot without having to be told what the mitzvot are. They knew Hashem's will. They knew how to connect to HaKadosh Baruch Hu without having to be told how to connect to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. We, unfortunately, are in a little bit more of a weaker space. So we need to be told, say a bracha, go and daven three times, say a kapitel tehillim, do an act of chesed, cook for the neighbor, don't yell, don't get angry. We have to be told guidelines. They were so connected to Hashem. They loved Hashem so much that naturally, so to speak, they acted in a way of Torah and mitzvahs.
But aren't the mitzvahs themselves the way to connect to Hashem? How were they able?
They did it naturally. That's what I'm saying. Right. They didn't have to be told to bless before eating. They knew it.
I mean, if we didn't have the mitzvot, we would be lost.
I'm going to tell you this. If we loved Hashem to the point where they loved Hashem, if we lived in the reality that we can't live a moment without Hashem, we would do mitzvot without even the conscious knowing that I just performed the mitzvah. It would be just like naturally. It would be get up in the morning and I know I need naturally a cup of coffee. Well, I don't know, whatever. My body tells me I need coffee in the morning. I naturally go and have a cup of coffee. I wouldn't have to be taught, I wouldn't have to be reminded to do mitzvot. You understand what I'm saying? It would come naturally. We're not at that level, so we have to be told, okay, pull this string when you want to kesher with Hashem. Oh, pull that string when you want to kesher with Hashem.
Well, say more down there.
Right.
Obviously, we should be thankful.
Right, exactly. We need to be told to do it.
So, it can be a time that said, Hashem, please, I want to love you so much, but I'm not there.
And that, beautiful point. And if I'm not there and I feel like I'm not in love with Hashem, yearning and loving Hashem. Ay, look at me. As a miskina, what a poor little soul I am. Look how far I've drifted. Look how many layers of brick concrete walls I've built for myself that I can't naturally love you. Where have I gone? Hashem, look how distant I am from you. Look how far I've strayed. That in itself is a reason to do tshuva. Forget. If I don't have that kesher with Hashem, that's the reason for all the transgressions. Why do I transgress? Because I don't feel Hashem's presence. If I knew that this camera from Torah Anytime was looking at me and filming everything that I did, boy, would I be careful. Boy, would I be careful. If I knew the fly on that wall was a camera, whoo, would I be careful.
Can I just say, it's so interesting. There are reality TV shows like that, but it's so different.
Why? Why? Why is that popular? Why is that? Everything
they
is
act to so they act as they would because yes. they get desensitized.
No,
camera.
they act repulsive.
Why has it become the new in reality shows? Because Hashem is saying our whole life is a reality, but it's a show. So, understand something. That's why Hashem created movies. Not for us to sit there and zonk out for 2 hours and forget life and run away from reality. It's because Hashem wanted to say, remember the time you couldn't imagine how was it that I was going to be able to record every one of your moves? Remember? And you couldn't even imagine. There was a time where you really couldn't imagine, like before the invention of tape recording. Could we ever even try to identify with the idea of someone recording an action or being able to instant messaging?
It's just so different when there's God in it, when there's not, because I mean, the way people react on reality TV shows as if something else drives them. I mean, they have no shame, nothing. They're knowing that the entire world is going to be watching what they're
and
doing.
And that's us too. That's us too. Well, we don't see that camera anymore.
You had that experience when your kids were making the show.
With the tablet? Let me tell you that. I want to tell you, honest, do it. Do it. Her kids
made a show, and she didn't know she was being recorded.
I was being videotaped from the tablet in my home, from like a little camera, and I didn't realize. No. My kids were like, you know, they like to put on shows, and they do kung fu, and they do dancing, and they put on all their hats and costumes. And I was in the background, and I was yelling. Let me tell you, it was a good humiliation. It was perfect. It was exactly, just thinking about it, I want to bury myself in the corner. It was so humiliating to see myself. And then the other day, I was flipping through the pictures trying to free up space, and I see myself like this. I promise you. I was so embarrassed. I said, for some reason, I like the word, Gul Nefesh. I said, that's disgusting of you. How would you look? Is that how you look to your children? Like, that was horrible. I was so embarrassed, but it was so good. It was perfect. I said, at least, how did they say, so long as the candle's still lit, I could still fix it. I could still delete it. I could still erase. I could still do tshuva. But it's, I'm telling every one of us, please do it. Just put it on there. And I know we don't want to see it, but we have to see ourselves. We're so not objective of the way that we really behave, the way we really, really are. It's
beautiful ways.
Okay. So the idea is that we have to know and live in the reality, as the Holy Baal Shem Tov says. We have to live in the reality. It's so important for us to understand Hashem is within us. We are within Hashem. Even if we think that we live without Hashem, we don't. It's not possible. Understand, we cannot sever our tie. What we can do is change our mode of consciousness. In other words, I can, chas v'shalom, delude myself into thinking that I'm without Hashem. That is enough for me to live in that reality. I actually create my own reality of living as if without Hashem, but it's not real. Again, it's not real because the reality is He's my lifeline. Hashem is my lifeline. I can't live without a Kadosh Baruch Hu. So if I get to the point in my life where I feel like Hashem is not there, it's a mode of consciousness. It's here. It's a matter of changing the mindset and bringing myself back. And that's why the words Enod Milvador are so powerful. Because I say the words and it brings me to the mode of consciousness of understanding that I am with Hashem always. There is no such a thing. So when I'm putting myself in that mode as if, God forbid, Hashem is not there, what I'm doing though is severing my vitality. And that's where sadness starts coming in. That emptiness of me not, I'm betraying who I really am. You see, when I'm disconnected, God forbid, from Hashem, I'm living a life of someone else. Because the truthfulness of me, I know this is very deep, but you know, this is very important, and I understand. When I'm disconnecting myself from Hashem, I'm living someone else's life. I'm not who I'm supposed to be. I'm living a fakehood. I'm living a falsehood. I'm living a facade of something I think I am, but it's not me. It's not who I really am. Me, the real me, we spoke of this last week. Me, the real me, the godly spark, who I really, really am, I'm not capable of being jealous. There's no such thing. I'm not capable of being jealous. I'm not capable of having any sense of hatred. It can't be. We spoke of that this month is Betulah. It's the mazel of the virgin. But I'm pure. I'm innocent. I'm undefiled. The real me is undefiled. I'm not capable of sinning. And so if I can be in touch with that me, that's my job this month.
Is it the real me or the potential that I have that I have to work
No, to? It's the real me. It's the real me, and my goal all my life is to get back to that me. Is to recognize that me. It's to uncover the me. It's not even to build it. I don't have to build it. It's there. I don't have to create anything. I don't need no toolbox to build. I need toolboxes. I need an axe to chisel. That's all I really need, is to chisel and to break what's hiding it. Emuna doesn't have to be built, it has to be recognized, it has to be revealed, it has to be uncovered. Constant speech with Hashem. Constant yearning. We said this is Yemei Ratzon. This is about displaying our fiery passion. But passion, yearning, screaming. If there's any time to cry out, this is the time. Crying out Hashem, to help me discover who I am. Help me understand, who am I? Who am I? I'm not mommy, and I'm not daughter, and I'm not the wife of, and I'm not the speaker who speaks Emuna. I have a purpose. There's something that I'm supposed to be doing. I didn't just come in here to be a mother. I didn't just come in here to be the wife of someone. I didn't just come in here in this world to do, those are acts, those are means to an end. Let's not get caught up with the world as it being the goal. There's something else. These are all tools for me to be able to understand who I am and why I'm here. And if I don't take the time out, this few days that are left to research and to find out who I am, how can I appoint Hashem to be my king? I don't know even why I'm here. So what are you going to be king? What are you going to be king over? Where are you going to lead me?
How do we get to that point? I mean, we come into this world pure neshama, right? I mean, they say that the reason that kids are everybody's so drawn to babies is they have the face of the Shekhinah. Mm-hmm. So how did we get so confused or disconnected from our own inner self?
It's the constant, we were always disconnected. We were brought into this world with the constant battle. That's why we're here. That's why we're here, is to fight out that battle. It's, when Adam HaRishon, I say this, when Adam HaRishon sinned, we're always going back to the origins of existence. When Adam HaRishon committed the sin, he didn't create evil. Evil was always there. You understand? Evil was always there. What he created was an admixture. There's a little bit of good in bad, and sometimes there's a little bit of bad in good. Our job is to separate. We're here to filter, sift. That's the job. Just constantly shift and sift and filter. And that's why there's so much confusion. It's not what did I do wrong that I'm confused. That's life. That's why I'm here. I'm here to be confused and find the right from wrong and differentiate and understand. No, it's not the electric company. No, it's not because, you know, I don't know, whatever, I didn't have enough money. My employer didn't pay me on time that I don't have enough money. It's not. It's Hashem. That's the sifting. That's constantly bringing everything back to the source. That's why I'm here. That is the battle of life, the battle of Emuna. That's Emuna. Is living what Emuna simply defined as the keen awareness of living that Hashem is in charge. And Hashem is doing everything. Everything. There's no such thing.
So I was here in the beginning of the class, but only one more week left until next
Because I have to get to the point in my life that I don't have much time left for these Yemei Ratzon. Elul, Hashem is here. He's going to be leaving soon. I have to take advantage of every moment that I can for that. We have clarity now that's given to us on a golden platter. I have to take advantage of that clarity.
Don't we do that all year?
Of course. But the clarity that I'm offered now during these Yemei Ratzon, I'm not getting all year round.
So what is the difference? We have one more week.
I have basically, to Hashem's good to us. He gives us two Yom Kippur, really. Till Ni'ila. When we do the Ni'ila, what is Ni'ila? We're
so
shutting the gates of heaven.
All this week, we have last week left for next
clarity.
Year. Preparation for next
yes.
year.
Yes, clarity. Now, understand something. Once Rosh Hashanah comes, Hashem gives us as a schut another 10 days. But really, this is the judgments on Rosh Hashanah. That's it.
For us, maybe we've lived more years than our children, and it may be a little bit easier for us to have clarity. But I look at my children growing up in this generation where evil, unfortunately, seems to become such a predominant thing that I feel that it will be very hard for this next generation to be able to find clarity. It's much harder to find the emet. Like I told you, when I went to the States, I felt like, how do people hold their job over there anymore? It's just so, Hashem is hidden, the world has changed, and how do we still get to clarity given what's going on?
The only way that any of us have and will come back to Tshuva is only from Chesed. Only from Chesed Elyon, Matnat Chinam. Only Matnat Chinam. Someone up there, they say if it wasn't for our ancestors, none of us would be living. None of us would have any clarity. Someone up there davened before, is davening now, and has tzviyot for us. All these tzaddikim that have left the world, all these rabbein, they're all davening for us. And if we didn't have rachamei shamayim, we'd be lost. We'd be lost cases. So that's why, that's him saying, thank you, Hashem. Thank you, Hashem. Whatever little I was able to do, it's matana, even that's a gift, that's not mine. I spoke about this on the audio, if you listened from last week's Shabbat audio clip. I spoke about the whole idea of the gift of Shabbat. Everything's a gift, even the Kohanim, the Kohen Gadol, when he goes into to the Holy of Holies on Yom, it's called Matnat Avodah. Everything is a matana. Everything is a matana. Shabbos is a matana. That's how it was presented to Moshe Rabbeinu. Matana dola yafa yesh bebet knazai. And he has, and it's treasure. Everything is a matana. We are undeserving of everything that we have. And unless we live in that reality, that's what I'm saying. You know what? Let me get to a point that's very, very important. There's a beautiful Perek of Tehillim, Kuf Bet, 102, Pasuk 18, but I'm starting with a little bit of everything, but I'm going to focus on Yud Chet. It begins off Tefillah La'ani. I don't know if I mentioned this before. There's three Tefillot in Tefillim, in the Tehillim. There's Tefillah LaMoshe, there's Tefillah LaDavid, and there's Tefillah La'ani. And the Zohar Kadosh in Parashat Balak teaches us that the most beautiful and loving and accepted and favorable tefillah is the tefillah le'ani. In other words, the tefillah, the prayer that comes out from the heart of a poor person, of a pauper, is the it's more lofty and more accepted in Shemayim than the tefillah of Moshe Rabbeinu, of David HaMelech. Why? So we're gonna see how this is amazingly, beautifully connected to the tefillahs of Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur. What is the tefillah of Ani? I'm a poor person. I'm a pauper. I'm on my last crumb of bread. I have nothing left. Hashem, do you understand? I'm broken. I have nothing left. If you don't come in and provide for me, I am going to just faint. I have nothing. I come to Hashem literally like there's nothing. And let us all understand one thing. A little bit of Musar doesn't hurt any of us a week before Rosh Hashanah. Every single one of us is coming on Rosh Hashanah with zero in their bank account. Every one of us. I don't care if any one of us has $10,000 in the bank. and a fully paid house and a car with no car payments and money for my great-grandchildren, we are all coming to Rosh Hashanah with zero. Zero. No husband, no children, no health, no money, nothing. We come starting from zero. And we're asking Hashem to not only give us what he gave us last year that I entered in Rosh Hashanah, but to continue to give it to me and give me more. If we approach Rosh Hashanah that way, I promise all of us, we're already entering into the Heichal, to the gate of the Tefillah of Ani. The Tefillah of the Ani is, I have nothing. I need you, Hashem. I cannot live without you, Hashem. I have nothing. It doesn't matter. It's all a facade. I think that I have a home, and I think I have beautiful furniture, and I think I have my health, and I think I have these wonderful children. I think, but I have nothing. Because every day Hashem renews creation. Every moment Hashem still gives us. Every moment. And if Hashem doesn't give me in 1 second, I'm not going to have what I had the second before. All the time I'm dependent on Hashem. But what's the beauty of Yom Kippur and Rosh Hashanah? This is the most exquisite, one of the most exquisite teachings Be'ezrat Hashem I have the sword to teach. It says in this particular parak, Kuf Bet in Tehillim, Pana el tefilat ha'al, ve'lo vaza et tefilatam. That's Pasuk Yud Chet. Hashem has turned to the prayer of those who cried out, and he did not despise their prayer. Chazal teach us that in order, let's talk about tefillah for 1 minute. In the order, there's two conditions if we really want to elevate our tefillot. If we really want to gain the most out of our tefillot in terms of being answered and in terms of connecting to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, two conditions need to be met. The first condition, Hashem, I'm broken. I'm in trouble. I'm in pain. I'm lacking. I'm in need. I have a void, I'm in sorrow, anguish, disturbance, sadness, all the negativity. I have to be in a place of pain and distress and a void. Condition number one. Condition number two, and so we're going to talk about why. Condition number two, I have to be, not 99.9, not 99.9 and 99.9, I have to be 100% relying on a Kaddish bar. I cannot assume that the next door neighbor who runs an amazing gemach said he's going to cover my bills for the chagim. He's going to drop me off a case of chicken and all the vegetables that I need for the chag. And so I'm a sedom. I'm okay. I have everything I need. 100%, I have to see everything 100%. From Hashem, and I have to rely, but truthfully rely. Again, no twitches inside. Hashem reads us. No twitches inside that, well, you know, really, that person did say, and, you know, I am expecting the check. No, 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 no. 100% reliance on Hashem. If I don't have those two conditions, then there's a defect, so to speak, in my tefillah, and that could chas v'shalom put me in a position where my tefillah is not going to be answered and it's not going to connect me 100%. There's going to be a shortage in the electrical circuit and I'm not going to be 100% zapped with electricity and emuna from Hashem. Those two conditions have to be met. What does the Chazal teach us? Amazing, amazing teaching. It's only on Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur that we're zoche to the tefillah. Tefillat, pana al tefillat ha'al. That I am zoche to the tefillah of the al. The al, what does it mean? Al is someone who's confused, someone who's weak, someone who's poor, someone who's despondent, who doesn't know where should I go, what should I do, how should I turn. There's no way in during the year that I could reach 100% that place of disparity, so to speak, of I have no one else to rely on. I need you, Hashem. Not only do I need you, but I'm in so much pain. I have nothing. My life is in your hands, Rosh Hashanah. Who doesn't feel? Our lives are in Hashem's hands. Who doesn't? I mean, God willing, we all come to Rosh Hashanah. We feel that. So Chazal teach us that the tefillah of the Al-Al, the tefillah of the Ani, once a year we get to have the tefillah, and that's on Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur. Look what a lofty place we could reach on Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur. But it only comes with preparation. I can't go from 0 to 100 and feel, oh, I'm with you, Hashem. Wait, where's the steps? Where's the training of the heart? I need to do it all year round. But in particular now, Elul, I have to work on myself to convince myself, to brainwash myself, to crush my ego and convince myself that I'm not in control of my life. That nothing that I think is really controlling me, that nothing that's going on in my life is going to continue. I'm starting at 0. I'm 100% dependent on you, Hashem. So we have one more week to convince ourselves that we're all living a delusional life, that we think that we're in control. It's my business, it's the new deal that I got, it's the new venture I'm entering. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. So if we could work on those two conditions, Be'ezrat Hashem, we could elevate ourselves to enter Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur and feel ourselves bemet the way we really are. I mean, just to go just a tad bit into current events, does anyone feel here that the ground we're standing on is very shaky?
Yeah, that's awful.
Does any of us really need a training of the heart that much to feel like we're in dire need of Rachamei Shemayim? I mean, I don't know if anyone knows, but last week the Pope announced that we have officially begun World War III.
What?
Not that I needed the Pope to say.
Why? Because of ISIS?
Yeah.
What?
That's all the nations are. What is it? Yeah, one of the prophecies, one nation's going to be fighting the next.
Over 40 nations, including Arab nations, met in Paris this week. And they're starting to physically, like, bomb with planes.
Let me tell you, this year is monumental. There are some rebellion. And I don't prophesize, but I'm telling you, I listen to Rebbeim all day. I listen. Everyone's saying this is probably the last Rosh Hashanah as we know it. The last Rosh Hashanah as we know it. Are we understanding that? I mean, we don't need to be injected with anything. Do we?
It's all because
we're in the 49th Shemitah year. And the Zohar Kadosh says, En Mashiach ba ela besof. In other words, Tchilat Hamishim. Hashem gave us a hint that at the end of the Shemitah, the 49th Shemitah year, Mashiach ben David Bezrat Hashem Yavon is going to come. There's so many signs, forget it. But we don't have the signs.
They had the 49th Shemitah before.
This is the 49th Shemitah. That's according to the Rebbeim that I was
starting from. Probably 300 years ago.
I think from the creation. From the time of the Torah, from the time of the giving of the Torah, since Shemitah. In any case, again, if we've been on the bus and we've been looking out the window, every one of us is going back to the same parable. We'll all see that the final destination is coming up rapidly, rapidly, real, real soon. And if the Mussar is not enough, if the learning Emuna and also extracting the value of what it could do for me in my world here today, like I said, if I live disconnected from my own neshama, I'm betraying myself, I'm living a life of someone else. I'm not living who I really am. And that's where all of the negative emotions arise. Let us be very clear. If I'm not living out my purpose, negativity will begin to arise in various different areas and times in my life. That's the soul. That's the way our soul speaks to us, through our emotions. If I'm emotionally not happy in my life, I'm not living out. I've somehow detoured from my purpose. And so it's not just God willing to build my eternal life and to have a share in Hashem's eternity. Wow, Hashem's eternity. It's not just that, but it's for me, for whatever. I'm in here, I'm right now living in this world. I want to enjoy. Hashem gave us this world not to just let it pass, but Hashem wants us to enjoy. He wants us to smell the roses along the way.
So you don't show that by emotions. I know a person who is very emotionally stable and happy all the time, but she's not connected to Hakadosh Baruch Hu bichlal.
I'm telling you, nobody goes to bed with the people who say that they are 100% and they're 100% happy.
No, because nobody. Some of them probably do because they're so ignorant and disconnected. They don't
that's part of the facade. It depends on how many layers of concrete they put against.
But there is no 100%
conscious. But I'm telling you that they have moments. They have every. Yeah, there's no
has,
such thing.
Everyone.
No
has.
Such thing. The neshama is very loud. It knows how to speak.
But
it knows
how to speak very loud.
Then why is everyone so far away?
Because they quiet it. It's like quieting a. You know, we all have intuition and we quiet it. Oh, wait. One second. We walk through the street and we feel. Oh, stop it. You're just being paranoid, right? We quiet it down. We're constantly quieting that little still voice inside of us. We can quiet it and quiet it and quiet it, but it keeps coming back. Mm-hmm. It keeps coming back. So there's no such thing. A Jewish neshama, it's a spark of godliness. Trust me when I say this. I don't live in anybody's life, and I don't know what really. But there's no such thing that they don't feel the pangs of consciousness. There's no such thing.
So what is your advice? I mean, you should say, what is this? Try to make Jewish positive thinking.
Just reaching out constantly, Hashem, like a pauper. We said that's the biggest mala is tefillah lani. I'm poor. I'm at the door, someone's door now, and if that person doesn't give me 10 shekel to buy myself a drink and a piece of bread, I'm gonna faint at their doorstep. That's the approach. That's the approach. And let me tell you, on Rosh Hashanah, that's not far-fetched. That's exactly what it is. Not that all year round it's not that way, but on Rosh Hashanah it's 100%. And most of us feel that way.
A little confusing. You want to be happy and poor?
Okay. So we're happy. The reason why we celebrate is because Hashem has given us the opportunity. If we've done the job properly, we should go into Rosh Hashanah feeling rest assured. Again, we're still.
So we're just kind of like happy just to have that breath. We're thankful
we're
to have that.
And we're happy that it's Hashem who's judging us. Because I trust you, Hashem. I've appointed you. I know you're my master. I know you're going to judge. You're going to judge me. You've seen the avoda that I've done. We still have to daven on Rosh Hashanah. We still have to wake up early and use the time and daven and so on. But I can go in there feeling, like you said, a little bit of a sense of relief. That I've really done as much of my work that I could have. I've used up every moment that I can. You know, I've realigned myself that much more. Yeah. Be'ezrat Hashem, may we be inscribed and sealed and stamped for a wonderful year, a year of Kedusha, of Tahara, of Yeshuot, of Nechamot. May none of us know of any more sorrow, not privately, not collectively. May we see the Geula Shlema Berachamim. May we come back to Tshuva Berachamim without Yisurim, but from the awakening, just to feel that spark, to feel, oh, I've just been pinched. Oh, I'm alive, I'm awake, I'm realigned. That's the way we should come back to Tshuva. Hashem Berachamim, the Geula, and Nechamot, and Yeshuot, and Atzlachot, and all the brachas in the Torah should shower and rain on every single one of us. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.